friend of mine and is Michel Montas. And some of you will have seen Jonathan Demme's film called The Agronomist, which is about a martyred journalist. And that's her. She's his widow, Jean-Dominique, who was killed in Haiti. He was murdered maybe 10 or 11 years ago. Anyway, they're both radio journalists and pro-democracy radio journalists. I asked her if she would help on a project, not this book, but and other people got together. We decided to go out to all, what is it, Jenny, 9 or 10 departments. The geographical, I'm looking at Jenny Block because she bought the tape recorders. You got to do things like that too, by the way. You have to have the infrastructure of inquiry. And a group of Haitians and a couple non-Haitians but who spoke fluent Creole just fanned out. And he asked people who were market women or fishermen or displaced people or people in the camps, street vendors, school kids, farmers, not farmers like me, but farmers with what do you want for your country? And the thing that was inspiring, and as you said, delicious, was that they didn't say, the theme that came back was not, we don't believe in the future of our country, none of that. They were actually optimistic about the possibility of reforming the state, making it work for the people, getting their kids back to school, and rebuilding the country in a way that would make it easier for them to live in Haiti. And there was something really inspiring about that theme, and she does a great job, Michel Montas does a great job on writing the chapter too. I haven't listened to the audio version of the book, but she does her own chapter. I said, no, I want Meryl Streep to do mine because I'm the Meryl Streep of public health.
I heard a story, by the way, I'm going to share, which was in New York. There was a get-together, and Meryl Streep was in the same room with, and everybody was around Meryl Streep, and then Paul Farmer walks in, and suddenly Meryl Streep is all alone in the corner, and they're all...
It was at NYU, not the Oscars.
So it was within a certain community of people who... For whom
Meryl Streep did read a lot of it, but Michel Montas reads her own. She has a beautiful voice too.
And we love Meryl Streep.
She's a great person. So just so if you get a chance, do listen and read what the Haitians have to say about this. And Michel, thank you for bringing that
up. My final question, Doc, what's the prognosis?
I think the prognosis, if you go back to that chapter, the prognosis is good. Someone said, well, you said, what's the allergy? What's the great resource of Haiti? It's people. And, you know, anybody can say that, but there's a lot of talent in Haiti and a lot of young talent in Haiti, right? There are lots of, it's a young country in terms of the demographics. And then we didn't get a chance to talk about the diaspora, but in the book, I write about some of my students from Harvard who are Haitian and who are, you know, so committed to working in Haiti. And one of them, who I don't want to, you can read about him, but one of them, he was a Harvard medical school student, grew up in Canada, you know, went to school in the United States, was, as I said, at Harvard Medical School. And he said to me, I remember the first week of school, his name's Terry. He said, of course, all the Americans said, hey, Terry, what's up? So he said, I want to go to Haiti. And he'd never been to Haiti, turns out. And I said, what kind of medicine you want to do? He said, surgery. I said, well, we definitely have a place for someone who wants to be a surgeon. So his first time in Haiti was coming back as a young adult, working in the operating room. And he'd work in the operating room up in central Haiti and spend the weekends with his family, who was getting to know again, his aunts and uncles, and many, many cousins. And his aunt and uncle were killed in the earthquake. And so he brought all of his cousins, and there were 8 of them. And I know that because he sent me an email, a picture of them in Montreal with his parents. Can you imagine thinking, yeah, we got our kids out, we're going to enjoy empty nest syndrome, then they get 8 more. So, you know, that's the kind of story, of course, that's a story of great adversity for that family, but it's also the story of really how the Haitian people can be. Yes, we'll take our cousins in, We'll make sure they grow up safely. And this young man, I was going to say this kid, is indeed now doing a surgical residency. And I meet people like that a lot, and we don't have enough of their stories out there. And so that's just an example of not only the Haitian people in Haiti, making the prognosis good, but also there's a diaspora that I think we still have yet to draw on fully.
Haitians helping Haitians.
Yeah, that's the big theme in the book.
So I guess we should have questions.
Dr. Farmer, I'm here with some high school student leaders and colleagues, and we are part of the Episcopal Schools Education Partnership in Haiti. And about 2.5 hours from Conche is a village along the Arc of the Night called Sival. And we went last year for the first time. We're going again. It's about 400 families there. About 25% of the young people clearly were malnourished. And our question, we go with Père Joseph Jean Genot.
Yeah.
And our question is,
is a good friend of mine.
We want to get community health workers there, as well as food aid. We're going to build a modest school, but even Père Genot thought that we would be more effective in figuring out a way to get the health workers in there and the food aid than he has been able to do. And so, can you give us some advice on how to do that?
I sure can. You know, it's great that the students who are with you and you, their teacher, are willing to shoulder some of this burden. You know, Father Genot, after all, you know, he has so many duties, as do a lot of people who serve, as he does, as a living link between, in this case, the United States and Haiti. And that's a very difficult role. I've done it all my life, is to be, you end up being a choke point as well, right? Because there's so much, I told you half of American households donated Haitian earthquake relief. And on the other end, there's great need. So it's hard to be in the middle because you don't want to. And I want you to take my advice
as more advice to you than to him, right? Because he's already working 60 hours a week or however many. And my advice to you is, if you're going to get involved in food aid, try and think about food security and food sovereignty. And this is my colleagues from New York. I make them sound like, you know, people with briefcases, and my colleagues from New York. They're actually all ladies in smart suits. But we're working on this accompaniment effort because we're not trying to say you need to do your food programs better and only procure local food, right? What we're saying is you need to think about local food procurement in a very humble and congenial tone, and this is how we've done it. Haiti is the most food insecure country in the hemisphere. It is the ranking problem for many families. You said 25%, doesn't surprise me. And unfortunately, what's happened with food aid, if you go back to the history of food aid in Haiti, it's largely surplus grain from the United States or Canada or elsewhere that is, I'm not going to say dumped, but that is being moved to Haiti, which can then increase this cycle of dependency because it undercuts the value of local food production, right? So, and we did this for years. You know, you have a school lunch program. You know, we're still probably still doing it. We're trying to move away from that and not use those food sources, but buy produce locally. And we're not, you know, we're not there yet. But ideally, that's where we're going, because then you support local farmers. You make sure kids get a nutritious meal, which of course every study shows that for kids not to get a meal in school means they perform less well. And that's true in the United States as it is in Haiti. But it's especially true when the best meal of the day, though, maybe is coming during school.